Hello everyone, and welcome to this short video where I'll talk about something called SPSS, which is the Statistical Package for the Social Sciences. So some people might be familiar with this already, in which case then this video might be a quick refresher for you, but other people, you might not have come across this software before. So the software is produced by IBM. It is a paid for software, but we have a license with, so the University of Worcester has a license with IBM, which would allow you to use the software, so download it and install it and use it on your own devices, as long as they're a laptop or a MacBook. It won't work on things like a Chromebook. But obviously, once you have your login details with the university, you can do that. But for now, you might want to try SPSS statistics for free from a trial from IBM, just to play around with it if it's something you haven't come across before. But don't feel you have to buy the software yourself. As I said, this would come as part of your psychology course. But you could fill out this free trial account, and then you can have, I think it's for a 2-week period, you could play around with SPSS. I have access to a range of different versions of SPSS. You would only need to download one. The latest version that we have at the moment is SPSS Statistics 27. But it depends really on what platform you're using. So if you're using an older machine, then you might need to download a slightly older version of SPSS. So I think version 23 works with some of the older platforms, the older Windows platforms. But if I just double click on SPSS, and it will start to open. Now SPSS can take a little while to open. But once you have it downloaded and installed, this is what it will look like when you start to run the program. So you can access perhaps a new data set, or once you've been sort of working on some of your assignments, you'll have your own data sets already, so it keeps a log of your recent files and so on. But we'll create a new data set just for the moment. So SPSS has two views. The first view is the data view, and the second view is the variable view. Now I'm just going to give you a brief orientation to this. You will have a lot more detailed guidance and support in using SPSS, so don't worry about it if you haven't used it before. But the data view, the layout is very similar to Microsoft Excel. So this is where you would put in all of the data perhaps that you've collected from a questionnaire. And so in this case, each row usually represents one person's data. But in order for SPSS to know what that data represents, then you need to look at something called the variable view. And this is where you tell SPSS what each piece of information means. So for example, I might want the first column of data in my data set to be about people's age. So I could type that in. And once I've typed that in, it will bring up a whole range of information. I can tell SPSS, so what is age? So it's a numeric value. So that means it should be treated as a number, not as a word. And if we go back to our data view, you can see that it started to plug that information in, so that when we put some information in this first cell, so this is called a cell, perhaps our first participant, we'll make this up, was 21. So SPSS knows that that person, that information is their age, and it should record it as a number. This is participant one's age. We might go back to our variable view. Perhaps we want to add something. So perhaps we want to put in someone's height as well. So we would type that in. Again, it brings up a lot of default options. Default settings, it's going to treat it as a number rather than a word, and we could put that in, and maybe we'll put 150 centimeters. We'll make something up, and so on. So each row represents one person's data. So this is person two. We'll say that they're only 12, and they're 110 centimetres or so on. So I'm just making those heights up. So once you have some data in SPSS, it's always handy to save it. There is no auto recovery function in SPSS, so it's important to save data regularly. But we could save in a very similar way to you would to Excel. I'll just call this test data and just save that to my desktop for now. And you can see now it's named our data set whatever we want it to. So you can see actually the two views, how they work. As I said, you'll have a lot more support on how to set up your databases correctly. So you can see that actually in some respects SPSS seems quite similar to Excel, but actually it can do a lot more. So in terms of things like descriptive statistics that you encountered in mini lecture 2 and inferential statistics which you encountered in mini lecture 3 on this module, this is how you can produce that information. So it's something that could be very useful for your advanced research analysis module that you're going to do, or advanced research methods module, but also if you're thinking down the line of conducting some quantitative research, this might be a piece of software that you use to help analyze your data that you collect. So you can see that if I go to analyze, there's a whole range of different approaches to analysis that you can use, and we'll be going through perhaps some of these as part of your course. There are a whole range of charts you can build once you have some data entered. So you can create things like bar charts, histograms, which we encountered a little bit earlier, and scatter plots and so on. So there's a lot you can do. And it's a good way of storing information. So this is, as I said, the data file. So anything that's got a .sav after its name is a data file. So this is where you plug in all of your raw data and where you tell SPSS what that raw data should be called and what type of data it is and so on. But whenever you start doing anything in SPSS, by default, an output file will also appear. Now this can be saved as either a .spv or a .spo sometimes, depending on the version of SPSS you're using. And what this does is it keeps a log of everything that you do in SPSS. So you can see that the first action was to create a new file, then it gave it a temporary name of dataset 1, and then the next thing I did really was to save the file. And that's where my dataset has been saved to, and that's what it's called. But if you produce any kind of statistical output, any graphs, anything like that, this is where it will be stored. So to give you an example, perhaps I want to know the mean age of our two individuals. So I might right-click on the column header age, and I can very quickly just produce some descriptive statistics, and you can see this is what it's done. Okay, so we have valid two cases, no missing data because we know both our two participants' ages. We know the mode, which doesn't make much sense really because there's only two values. We know the range in ages, and we know what the minimum and maximum are. And then we've got a frequency of ages as well. Now perhaps we also want the mean, so what we can do is to go, I'll show you a different route to doing this. If you go to Analyze, you'll see something called Descriptive Statistics again. I'll go to Descriptives, and I will transfer the variable of age over to that, and I'll just click OK. And what we can see is this time it's brought up a mean age as well. And the standard deviation. So you should hopefully, after watching those mini lectures, be more familiar with each of these terms and why it's important to have things like descriptive statistics. But as I said, this is just a little introduction to SPSS, just to get a feel for it. If you haven't used it before, then feel free to download that trial from IBM, the main website. But don't pay for it, as once you've got all your login details for the University of Worcester, you'll be able to access the software for free. Okay. So thank you very much and have fun with SPSS.